I don't know if you have heard about the topic for today, practical geometry. You've probably heard about half of it, geometry. I had heard about that, but I wasn't quite sure what practical geometry was. Well, stay tuned. We're talking about that today. Welcome to the Simply Charlotte Mason podcast. I'm Sonia Schaefer. Today we want to talk about practical geometry and the place that it had in a Charlotte Mason education. Joining me is Dr. Julie Ryle and Tabitha Werges, authors of the new Charlotte Mason Practical Geometry course.
Yay!
We're so excited about that. First off, practical geometry. What is that?
It's practical.
That's why I'm asking, because my geometry course was, you know, formulas and proofs.
Yes.
And it was all writing things down that right over my head. Worst grade I had in all of my high school math was in geometry.
Okay.
And it's like, there's nothing practical about this.
And that's not uncommon. That's not an uncommon experience.
That was actually my experience. And I did well in it, but it was my least favorite math, actually.
So, what is practical geometry?
It's fun geometry.
So this is, this is geometry you would start in the later elementary or early middle school years. And so it gives them a taste of that geometry before we get to writing proofs and having to use complex formulas. But and it's all using tools, hands-on. It's very hands-on. So we're using a ruler and a compass, and they get experience with these tools. It's a lot of fun.
It's ancient tools that people... civilizations have been using for thousands of years, and we're continuing to use these same practical tools. So that's the practical part
of it. Okay, now it makes sense.
So that's why it's practical, because the ancient Egyptians used this in order to build the pyramids and many of their buildings that they have. And the Babylonians would have used the same thing, and the ancient Greeks as well. And so that makes it practical. See, it's the things you can use when you're building things, structures, outdoors, and so we're still using those, but we've made them smaller so that we can use them on our tables.
We don't have to go outside and actually build a pyramid.
Right, we can do the small thing.
So what are the benefits of it? You mentioned we're doing this before we get to the proof-based geometry. Why should those older elementary, middle school age kids do something like this?
Well, this is a hands-on. It's concrete. So Charlotte Mason started almost every subject this way, where it was the concrete. But especially with math, she's starting off with manipulatives and things that you can actually touch and handle, so that you know that when you're adding 2 + 2, it makes 4, because there's 4 in front of me, and it's not abstract.
Right.
And so those geometry concepts, those formulas that you're talking about, that's abstract. That's abstract thinking.
Very.
We're just like, well, why is that the formula for a circumference of a circle? Where did pi come from? And so that's what practical geometry gives them with alternate interior angles. This is why these are equal, because we're actually going to build them and measure them with our geometry tools and find out that these are the same. And actually, in our book, they do more than just build them and measure them with the tools. They actually take little pieces of paper where they're rotating them and seeing how they end up being the same.
That's an exercise my students have loved. We actually take little strips of cardboard and use a brad, and you move the strips of cardboard, and you can see the angles keeping the same measure as each other. And it's very practical and hands-on.
Yes. So you talk about Charlotte Mason and hands-on approaches, especially in math and discovery-based learning. Talk about some of the research you've done. I'm assuming you have done Charlotte Mason research to put together this course, and I know you have, but let's share some of that with our listeners.
Sure. So a book that Charlotte had actually in her own programs, using with her PNEU programs, was called Lessons in Experimental and Practical Geometry. It was written by two mathematicians, Hall and Stevens. It's over 100 years old.
Yeah, they wrote it because they had a geometry book, actually, and they realized that they had a lot of students that didn't understand these concrete base foundational ideas, and so they said, well, it'd be really nice if there was this precursor to geometry that was practical, and that they would understand why the angles of a triangle can only be 180 degrees. That's just the only way that this could even work if you added them all up. And so they put that together, this precursor book. It was meant to stand alone. You could do geometry without it, but they found it very helpful for students if they had done it beforehand. And Irene Stevens, who did a lot of Charlotte Mason's research when it came to math and helped her and guide her on great ways to learn math and explore with math mm-hmm. still and make math living still, suggested it to Charlotte Mason as a tool to use for parents when the PNEU schools.
So in about 5 years ago, we were at Tabitha and I were both at a Charlotte Mason homeschool conference together, and Rochelle Baborna was there.
Yeah.
And she was speaking on math and what Charlotte used in her schools. And that was my first introduction to the Holland Stevens book. And yours?
Mine was a little bit before that, not much. Still from Rochelle, though. She would have been the one that introduced me to it. And I had been perusing through it in the archives online and really excited about it. So I had seen it a little bit. As I said before, my experience with geometry was just rather dull.
But you both have degrees in mathematics.
Yes, I actually have a doctorate in math, and so I've taught at the collegiate level and the high school and middle school level, and so I had seen geometry used as
but
we use it.
But you'd never seen this book.
I'd seen it used as we use it in modern day in the high school level, but never seen this book before.
Yeah.
And when I saw it, I got so ecstatic. I was just thrilled with it. And it was actually the perfect timing. I had a daughter that was entering sixth grade at the time, and she was just at the right age. She was about that fifth grade math age. And so she was at the right age to go home and try it with her. And so I took this book home. And at that time, we actually schooled one day a week with another Charlotte Mason family. Mm. And so I had three late elementary middle school girls. And I was working through this book with them. And they really enjoyed it. We did it once a week together. And their mom actually really enjoyed going through it, too. She's a scientist. And she went through this book with us. And she was doing the hands-on work as well and enjoying it. And she has a little bit of math phobia, and she was quite intrigued by this
which
book.
Which is a little bewildering to us because she is so good at science. She's amazing at science, and math is the language of the sciences, and so we're just kind of like...
Yes, but if you have that math phobia, I mean, you know what that feels
hard.
Like.
It's hard to break past that, even if you know you have to use it sometimes.
And so she was so intrigued by these lessons, but I realized that this wasn't something she could take home and implement in her own home with her children.
The way it was written in
the way
book.
It was written. Holland Stevens wrote this for a math teacher to use in a classroom setting.
Oh, yes. Sure. Yeah. Yes.
And so this was written, the directions were not clear. You had to understand what they meant.
They were assuming the teacher would know how
exactly.
to teach this
exactly.
shorthand, exactly. if you will.
And the way that Charlotte used it, she didn't teach straight through from lesson one through the end of the book. Mm. She kind of hopped around, went through some of the precursory material, and then came back to the beginning and went through again. And so it wasn't clear to a homeschool mom how they should best use this book.
Yeah, yeah. I used it in a similar way. So not long after that conference, that next fall, I was using it in a private school setting, a Charlotte Mason private school setting. And so I had a classroom full of middle schoolers, actually. But they had never had practical geometry yet. And so we were going to do that one day a week, you know, because that was a great precursor. And I was just super excited about it. And anything that gets excited about math to carry on over to students. But it was also good for them to learn that before they came into formal geometry study. And so I started doing it within a classroom. And I mean, I was going through the same things that Julie was talking about, that I was having to redo all the lessons and tweak them for myself. And I wasn't the only middle school teacher. We actually shared it to where we each did different subjects for the middle schoolers so they could go to the different rooms and rotate like you would have done like in a public school setting kind of. And that way we could hone in on our skills. but I realized that I would not have been able to hand that book over to one of the other teachers and said, here, use this for your students over here. I would have had to take them through an entire lesson on like, okay, for this lesson, do this, this, and this, and then say this, and then do this exercise. And, like, and don't finish it off because you'll do that next year. And like, I wasn't going to be able to hand it off. I also ran into a lot of issues of realizing I have a lot of homeschool friends. And they, like one of them started her own business. She's a court reporter now. She's very intelligent. She can do all kinds of things. She has math phobia though. And especially if she hasn't seen it, she's got to see it written out. If I just tell her this is how this works, she's going to be like, what are you saying? on top of the math phobia that she has. And there was no way that I was going to be able to hand that book over to her. I was so excited about it. I think every person should go through practical geometry. It's very practical. But there was no way I could hand it to anybody else. And so that's where kind of blossomed that we wanted to do.
Yeah,
do the book
so
for everyone.
Tell the story then of how you got sucked into rewriting this book so homeschoolers can use it very easily and practically. as you say, I'd love to hear this story.
Now, we had people asking for some help in this realm. And so we batted around a few ideas. Do we write a solutions manual? Do we write just a teacher's guide that they could use with Holland Stevens' original book, telling them what exercises to use? Do we make a series of videos?
So
we had tossed around a few ideas. We were both at a very busy point in our lives with young children and teaching and
So we just kind of tossed these ideas around for a year or two, actually, before we were finally like, okay, this needs to happen. Parents need to have this. And actually, that point happened when the world shut down in 2020. And
how convenient.
Nobody can go anywhere.
It just aligned so beautifully.
And so, yeah, so like towards I guess, May of that year of 2020, we were chatting around to different moms, and I mean, we couldn't be places, and so we wanted you to be able to have fractal geometry, and yeah, so the world shut down, and we decided that we would write a book.
Yeah, and we had been in contact with Rochelle as she was writing her elementary arithmetic series, and we were thrilled to be able to partner and bring that together with her materials, and so, of course, then we got to partner with Simply Charlotte Mason, yeah, and bring this to the table, and as we began rewriting it, we realized that there were a lot of things that we wanted to update
and change. Yeah. Yeah. At first, we just were going to rearrange it in the way that we had been using it with our students and with our children. But yeah, as we jumped into it, we realized this needs a complete different format.
It's about 100 years old, right?
Yes, and some of the math terminology
is very different.
The terms mean different things in the math world today than did in that book. And so if you learn them that way, it's not going to translate to your high school math. And so we were just, it kind of grew. We were updating terminology, we were rearranging lessons, and then we were like,
I would introduce this this way.
I think this should be done this way. And we took some other older geometry texts and took some inspiration from there and built, I think, a good series.
Structure and series.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's
we
wonderful.
Also based it off of Charlotte Mason's lessons and the way that a math lesson should normally go, where you start off with review and then you explore the idea and then you narrate it. And so that's how the lessons, we didn't want parents to have to figure that out as they opened it up to get going. We wanted them to be able to be like, okay, we're ready to go. We wanted students to be able to have this accessible to them. This is their knowledge that they're taking in, and so they could own it for themselves. And so it's written kind of neutrally to both of them so that you can take it and learn it and enjoy it.
And I love how you created the videos to go with it. Just not a video for every lesson, but some of the constructions and the tips that were in there are just a lot easier to grasp for some people if you can see it being done rather than reading it and looking at just the illustrations. Different learners are going to grab it in different ways. So I love the video component that you added to it just to help parents be able to
visualize, like,
yes,
oh, that's how you turn the compass, and oh, I hold the ruler over here. I'm going to be honest, there's some constructions where I even have to like work through it for a second and go, right, I need the ruler over here and the set square here. I have to be doing it before I can actually say, okay, this is how you should hold it.
Yeah.
So it just makes that so much easier to be able to see it.
It was very important for us that this was something that could be open and used in your home and not something that you purchase with the best intentions and put on your shelf. And I've done that. I have many books like that in my home. So we want it to be something that is usable by everyone.
We also didn't want you to have to go find more help like that we figured you were probably going to need. We didn't want you to have to go find that help from somewhere else where you have to take the time to go look for that information. I've been there. That takes time through my homeschool day that I could be spending with my children.
And it means the lesson is just not going to happen,
yes,
right?
I mean, if you have to do all those extra things. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So that way it's easy. It's right there. You can just go look at it real quick and then you can continue on with the lesson.
And this is used in conjunction with Charlotte Mason Elementary Arithmetic Series.
Mm-hmm.
How do you recommend this new course, the Charlotte Mason Practical Geometry course, be used?
We suggest that you use the elementary arithmetic 4 days a week and that you do the practical geometry lessons 1 day a week.
Starting in which book?
Oh, book five.
Book five.
Book five.
We're not doing this from book.
Not from the first book.
You guys have talked about middle school, so
yes.
Yes, sorry. We started using it with our students around the time they were in middle school, just that's when I found it.
Yeah. Perfect timing.
It's never too late. You can use it.
If a student has not gone through practical geometry, it would be great to pick this up And use it with a 7th or 8th grader, yes, before they get to high school geometry. Yes. But it is designed to go with CMEA Book 5. So that's the arithmetic level they need to be at before they can start doing the math that's in the practical geometry
book. Okay. That's why, because they have to have, yes, what, fractions?
It's meant to kind of go right in there with that.
And I assume, well, they've been learning about using a ruler and measurements and everything, and that's going to come into play as
exactly,
well.
Exactly, exactly. They need to know how to use a ruler and read a ruler.
And they've been doing the conversions between inches and centimeters and meters and, you know, metric, yes, and U.S.
Exactly,
standard. You
exactly
use both of those?
We do.
Course.
We use both in the course. We have give them experience with both. We go back and forth between the two. So they use both sides of the ruler.
So it's used along with that book. How? We do book 5?
4 days a week. And so practical geometry will be done 1 day a week. And a lot of families view this as their kind of fun math. It just gives the brain a break and lets you focus on something else. And this might be something that your student is especially successful at, to give them that boost in confidence.
Yeah, it gives a chance also a lot of times from the arithmetic book, you'll have a chance to kind of use what you've been learning in your arithmetic studies, and you can actually use it on these geometry lessons. And so that gets really fun too. So you've been practicing adding fractions, and you're going to come over here and add some fractions together, but you got to draw them, you know, so you can have some fun with that. But students could also, like, say you're in your arithmetic studies and you get to multiplying fractions and that just gets too hard, or you're to subtracting fractions and that gets too hard, and you just need to take a break from your arithmetic studies, or you're at a wall where you need to keep practicing that particular thing. And so in order to take a break from that, so you can keep reviewing that for part of your lesson and then do a few practical geometry lessons, so maybe you do more than one that week for a couple of weeks while your student catches up on that fraction lesson and gets that under their belt.
So you could even do the entire course in 36 school days and go through it if that's what you choose to do. So it can be, if you hit a wall in your arithmetic studies, sometimes it is best to pivot. You still want to be reviewing that arithmetic concept where you were stuck at.
Which you could do with mental math.
Exactly. So that could be your mental math lesson. And if your student just needs a break, we want to respect their personhood. And if that's what they need at that time, then we can step back and use practical geometry in that way. So there are many ways it could be used.
Yeah, exactly.
I've done that with a couple of my own kids, actually, where they get stuck around long division is usually the place that we get stuck at. And so we just cycle through, and we keep moving forward in their math lessons. We either cycle over to practical geometry, or I've even gone ahead and gone into fractions as we continue to review the long division at the very base level of manipulation. So we keep having math every single day, but we cycle over to these other things, and practical geometry is just a really great one. And you'll be amazed how far they come forward in this concept that seems so hard as you give their brain a break and do other things. It mm-hmm. also prevents not liking math. Like,
yes,
there's nothing worse to, like, just take all of the fire out of something than to just keep pushing it when it's hard.
Yeah, drill and kill.
Yes, yes.
It also could be used as a summer math. If you are schooling year-round and you wanted to do something a little bit different so that it felt fun for summer, it could be used in that way.
Lots of different mm-hmm. ways to use it. And I like how you're bringing to life that idea Charlotte talked about, that sometimes a change is as good as a break.
That's yes, right.
Just
exactly.
Using a different part of, and how you said some people who think that they don't like math or aren't good at math, here's a different type to try.
It's
and
a different study.
It's like with art, you mm-hmm. know, they might say, I'm not good at art, but all they've tried is pencil sketching.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Try pastels.
Yes.
You might be good at that. So, yeah.
Well, I think of it as reading, too. Like, you'll have people that will say they don't like reading. I'm like, well, maybe we just haven't found the right type of book for you.
Yeah. What are you reading? That
yeah,
might make
yeah.
a huge difference. Yeah. That's great. Well, we're so excited about this course. I know it's going to be a huge benefit to so many people. And keep writing, okay? Can you give us more like this?
We'll try.
Just, yes, you know, in your spare time. Just write
right,
some more.
Right.
That'd be great. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
If you enjoyed this podcast, be sure to subscribe so you don't miss an episode. There will be a link in the show notes to the Charlotte Mason Practical Geometry course that we've been talking about. I know you're going to love it. Check it out. Thanks for joining me. I'll see you next time.